President Trump has promised the American people a big, beautiful Christmas present in the form of major tax cuts. Can the GOP deliver, or will the bill get stuck in the chimney? Joining us from South Dakota to discuss that and much more, the number three Republican in the Senate, John Thune. Senator, you said recently you thought that President Trump could be influential, your word, in getting Roy Moore to step down. But as we have discussed today, the president is now siding with Judge Moore. And in fact, I want to put up a tweet that the president sent this morning. The last thing we need in Alabama and the U.S. Senate is a Schumer-Pelosi puppet who is weak on crime, weak on the border, bad for our military and our great vets, bad for our Second Amendment, and wants to raise taxes to the sky. Jones, the Democratic candidate, Doug Jones, would be a disaster. Senator, does that disappoint you where the president is now?
Well, I would like to see the president, Chris, come out and support what many of us have said, and that is that Roy Moore needs to step aside, allow somebody else to be a write-in candidate. We can win that seat. He is right. If the Democrat wins, it's going to be a vote for the Pelosi-Schumer agenda, which is going to be against tax reform, against constitutional judges, against smart borders. But the other alternative is if Roy Moore wins and he comes into the Senate in January, there's going to immediately be an ethics investigation, which is going to be a cloud that he'll be operating in, and it's going to be a distraction for us and for our agenda. So, you know, ultimately the decision's up to the people of Alabama, but it strikes me at least that it would be in their best interest and in the country's best interest, and certainly in the best interest of our agenda, if the president would use his influence to try to get Roy Moore to step aside.
So do you think the president has made a mistake in splitting with Senate leaders like yourself and Senator McConnell and going with Judge Moore?
Well, I can't, you know, the president obviously can speak for himself, but, and I think he sees the specter of a Democrat holding that seat and what that might mean for his agenda. But the alternative, as I said, isn't good either, Chris. And so as far as I'm concerned, the president, to the degree that he wants to use his influence in this race, could, I think, help everybody out by doing what he can to try and get Roy Moore to step aside, which is what we believe is in the best interest, again, certainly the country, certainly the president's agenda, and I would argue for the people of Alabama, although, like I said, that's a decision that they make, and they don't care a lot what Washington, D.C. thinks.
Let's talk about the big, or a couple of big issues that you're going to face on the Senate floor in the next week or two. The first is tax reform that should get to the full Senate floor this week. But it's in some trouble. There's one Republican senator, Ron Johnson of Wisconsin, who has already said that he's a no vote, and at least five others are on the fence. Is tax reform in real jeopardy in the Senate?
I believe it will pass, Chris. I think that in the end, and we have members who are expressing what are legitimate concerns, who are, have ideas about how to make the bill stronger and better, and we're certainly open to those, and we're going to have an open process on the floor of the United States Senate where people can offer amendments. Those amendments can get debated and voted upon. So there'll be plenty of opportunities to change the bill in the direction that some of our senators want to see. But on the other hand, we need to get this accomplishment. This is a goal that we've had for a long time. The tax code in this country needs to be changed. If we're going to be competitive in the global marketplace, our businesses are not competitive today. If we want to get the economy growing at a faster rate, creating better paying jobs, raising wages in this country, we need to get this tax bill across the finish line. And it also, our important goal in this is to deliver tax relief to middle income families. And the bill that we reported out of the Senate Finance Committee last week and that will be on the floor this week does that. And so these are all things that our members are for. I think in the end we'll get the votes, but it's a process. And a legislative process, it takes time to move it across the finish line, but I think we'll get a bill to the president.
I want to talk about one of the concerns that several of those senators that we just showed, of the half dozen senators, are concerned about, and that is that the official estimate is that the Senate tax bill, as it now stands, will add $1.4 trillion to the debt over the next decade. It would be even more, but as a budget gimmick, some personal tax cuts expire in 2025. You've made it clear you want to see those cuts made permanent, but if they are, that means the debt will go up even more than $2 trillion price tag for these tax cuts. As a fiscal conservative, Senator, are you okay with that, a tax cut that adds $2 trillion to the national debt?
Well, look, Chris, the thing that you have to remember about this, and our members all know this, all the senators voted for the budget that allowed us to move this tax bill through the Senate Finance Committee. And we believe that with a reasonable amount, a small, modest amount of economic growth, that number gets completely wiped out. All you have to do is get 0.4% of additional GDP. And remember, you know, the Congressional Budget Office, the official scorekeeper, says that we're only going to grow the economy at about 1.8 to 1.9% over the course of the next 10 years. We think we can do much better than that. That should not be the status quo. We should not settle for 2% growth in this economy. Smart tax policy, we think, can unleash this economy, generate much higher economic growth, consistent with historical standards, which have been in the 3 to 3.5% range. But even if we get up to 2.2 or 2.3, we cover the cost of this bill. So our senators, as they look at this, are going to be saying, okay, what does this do to growth in the economy? Is this a pro-growth tax bill? Will these policies generate faster growth and higher paying jobs and more government revenue? And in the end, we believe that it will.
One of the other things that Congress has to do is you got to fund the government, which runs out of money on December 8th. Will you avoid a shutdown? And before December 8th, are you going to pass a long-term spending bill that keeps the government solvent all the way to the end of the fiscal year next September? Or do you think you're going to end up just passing a 1 or 2 week extension to kick the can down the road again?
Well, we need to pass a long-term spending bill. Obviously, in the legislative process, the negotiation that will go on between the White House and Democrats in Congress and our leadership in Congress, sometimes you need to do a short-term extension. But ultimately, we need to do a bill that funds the government through the end of the next fiscal year and that addresses the important priorities that we need to address. We've got some disaster assistance for some of these areas of the country that have been affected by the weather in this last year, the hurricanes, and also some other things that need to be done in the year-end bill. But we shouldn't have there shouldn't be any discussion about shutting down the government. We can make this thing work. We just need to get people to the table, negotiate it. I think the president's bringing the leadership in the House and the Senate to his office later this week to do that.
Well, let's talk about one key issue, because the Democrats are saying if you want and you need their votes, you can't do this through budget reconciliation with just 51 votes. So you're going to need the Democrats on board. And they're saying the price is that you've got to have a DACA fix, that you have to find a way to protect the so-called dreamers as part of this spending compromise. Is that something that Republicans like yourself are willing to accept?
I don't think that ought to be in this bill. This bill ought to be about funding the government. DACA is a big issue. Immigration is a big issue. There's a lot of sympathy for assisting those, you know, young men and women who are in this country through no fault of their own, who are here illegally through no fault of their own, at the same time doing something about border security. We think those issues need to be coupled. But that's a big issue. That is a consequential legislative issue that needs to be dealt with, but it shouldn't be dealt with in the context of a year-end spending bill and the Democrats using it and trying to use leverage to shut down the government. That's not how this ought to be resolved. Let's do the spending issue. We'll negotiate that with the Democrats. The DACA issue and border security need to be negotiated separately, hopefully sometime next year.
All right. I want to deal finally with an only in Washington situation is that we now have an agency here in the nation's capital with two dueling directors. And folks may not have been following this over the holiday weekend. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau was created as part of Dodd-Frank to oversee companies that lend to consumers, but Republicans have opposed it from the start. The director quit on Friday and named his chief of staff. This is a Democratic director, holdover from the Obama administration, Leandra English, to be the acting director, but the president named Budget Chief Mick Mulvaney to run CFPB. Question, when the agency returns to work tomorrow, who's in charge?
I think Mick Mulvaney will be in charge, and I think very much it sounds like now that Justice Department has come out in support of the president's position on this. Ultimately, this may end up in court, but the CFPB was created as an agency, Chris, in the first place that had very little accountability, very little transparency, really no oversight to Congress, And it's an agency that needs to be reformed. So I expect that Mick Mulvaney will be on the job, and he'll be calling the shots over there.
But, you know, there is, as you well know, there are competing interests here because, yes, you're right, the Justice Department says the president has the right to put Mulvaney in the job. On the other hand, under Dodd-Frank, the way the law is written is the deputy director, in the terms of a vacancy, becomes an acting director until the president nominates somebody who's confirmed by the Senate. Is this something that you think that Congress may have to get involved with to try to sort out? Because if we're talking about a court case, this could take a long time.
Well, it could, and the best thing Congress can do is that the president make a permanent nomination, and we'll process it as quickly as we can in the Senate and get somebody installed as soon as possible. That ultimately is the best way to resolve this. But in the meantime, the president's made this appointment. I suspect maybe that it gets litigated, that it ends up in court. But I think for the foreseeable future, at least, my expectation is that Mick Mulvaney will be in that job. But I hope in the end it results in reforms to that agency, which has right. Essentially very little accountability to the Congress or anybody else.
Senator Thune, thank you. Thanks for your time, and we'll be following all the action in the Senate this week. Thank you, sir.
Thanks, Chris. Great to be with you.